Hi, I thought I'd do a quick video and show you 20 singles, 45s, that influence my life and my music tastes. So without further ado, let's get into it. I've got 20 singles here, you know these things, 45s, that I've had since they came out. From all my many, many thousands of singles, are probably my all-time favorites. And they start in 1970 and they only go through until 1978. So that that 8-year period really formed my tastes as they are now. And every time I hear these records, it takes me back to what I was doing at the time, or thinking even, and helps me to remember all the great times we had as kids growing up in the southwest of the UK. So without further ado, I'm gonna talk a little bit about each of these and play a little snippet, not too much so it doesn't get thrown off YouTube, but I hope you enjoy it, and please leave comments below. Here's the first single. My brother used to have this, played it to death. I didn't actually have this single at the time, but it was so influential to me. It was before I really got into music. This one was 1970, and it's McGuinness Flint, When I'm Dead and Gone on Capitol, and on the flip side is Lazy Afternoon, another superb track, and a single that just reminds me of those times, my brother playing music in our shared bedroom, and this is one of his favorites, and obviously wore off on me. Another one actually that was on this little EP with two tracks on each side. The first one is Life is a Long Song by Jethro Tull, my brother's favourite band in the 70s and still today, I believe. And Up the Pool on side one, and on side two, it's got Dr. Bogan Broom from later. Oh, and Nursey. So three tracks on side two, but it's really Life is a Long Song that was the track that we played to death on this one. So I really got into music through watching Top of the Pops, and also a friend of mine, his father had made the most amazing hi-fi system, literally from scratch. The art, the tone arm of the turntable, the speaker cabinets, everything, and it was an amazing sounding system. And I used to go across the road to my friend Mark's house, and he was allowed to play this. Well, I think he was, but we used to play it maybe when his dad was out. And we had a couple of singles between us, and a couple of albums. And the albums were those really cheap Top of the Pops albums, which had all the latest hits of the day. And I heard later in life that Elton John had played and sung on many, many of those, if not all of them. Things like Chicory Tip and stuff like that was on it, and the Free Electric Band, and various other tracks. But the singles we played to death were this one, a superb A and B side, and it was really it was after Space Oddity had originally come out, which was 1969, and this was 1971, 72 when I heard this. So this is the amazing single Space Oddity, and The Man Who Sold the World on the flip side, an amazing record, just has always been a favorite. Both those tracks. I love the albums they've come from. The amazing Mick Rock video, and from that era, and also his amazing photos. It's really really framed Bowie, and really his whole 70s persona was really marked by the imagery from Mick Rock on these early albums. So that's an original single, but I managed to find a 1969 mono version of Space Oddity with the Wild Eyed Boy from Free Cloud on Philips. So this is really the original, and a great find, and a different version. It's in mono, as I said, and it's fantastic, but I still love my original.
Ground control to Major Tom. Ground control to Major Tom. Ground control to Major Tom.
From 1971. So in that same year, because, you know, in that period of the 70s, people were releasing more than one album a year, almost unheard of now. And I haven't got the original cover for this, so I bought a new reissue cover for it, and I need to get the picture cover because it had an amazing picture on it. But this is Life on Mars. Also has The Man Who Sold the World on the flip side. But Life on Mars was an amazing track, still is. The amazing Rick Wakeman on keyboards. Simply love this. And the interesting thing is, at the end of this track, you hear a phone ringing, and I think Bowie saying, "I'll get that," or somebody says, "I'll get that," and it was from Trident Studios in London, in just off Wardour Street. And, you know, some 7 years later, I was to go to London, and I started off as a tea boy in that very studio. So this, everything about this has great meaning for me, and you know, made me apply there to get a job, and that's how I started my London working.
It's a god-awful small affair to the girl with a nasty hair, but her mommy is yelling no.
So this record came out in 1972, but I really heard it first in 1977. I was going to sixth form college to do A-levels in Weston-super-Mare, and there was a pub very near, and we used to creep out at lunchtime and go to this pub where you'd often get tutors also in the lounge bar, and we used to go into the public bar. And they have the most amazing, amazing jukebox. And there are many tracks on there, like Boys Are Back in Town, Positively 4th Street by Dylan, and this one. And I thought, that sounds so much like Rod Stewart. And I found out that it was. So it's Python Lee Jackson in A Broken Dream with Rod Stewart on vocals. An absolutely amazing record. Probably, to this day, my favourite Rod Stewart record. And we literally played this to death on that jukebox. So it has great memories for me. The beer there, which we used to drink by the half a pint, used to get in a little beer glass with a handle, called a handle. And it was Ben Truman beer, and it was 15p for a half pint and 30p for a pint. How times have changed. Obviously, being into Bowie, this next artist, you know, anyone into Bowie also had to be into T-Rex. And my brother had bought very early on the very first T-Rex single. So not the first Bolan single, but the first T-Rex single. And that was Ride a White Swan. And then he bought Hot Love. I must have played those on my record player over and over again. Absolutely love them. But my first single that I bought from T-Rex was Metal Guru. And I remember seeing this on Top of the Pops. And he was very glammed up and it, you know, sparkly face and all the rest of it. It was so amazing. It was a hell of an experience. And it's probably in the top five T-Rex records that I love. And of course, produced by the amazing Tony Visconti, who produced Bowie albums all the way through his career, on and off, and is still touring with a Bowie band, when they're allowed to tour after COVID-19. But they tend to take entire Bowie albums and play the whole album end to end, with Woody Woodmansee on drums, the only remaining spider from the Spiders from Mars, and Tony Visconti on bass. Amazing guy, amazing producer, and an amazing record. Another one my brother used to play to death. I didn't originally have this, but I did find a really nice copy of it. My brother had an album called Bandstand by Family. And Family go back quite a way, but this one's from 1972. And my brother played this album over and over again, but I think it might have been the first track on the album. But this single, Burlesque, was a chart hit, so it was on Top of the Pops. It had John Peel on Top of the Pops playing on it, I think, or was that a Rod Stewart? No, that was a Rod Stewart one. I think he might have played on this as well. But he wasn't really playing, he was just on Top of the Pops. And Family and Burlesque, this was such a great single. Roger Chapman's vocals warbling and Whitney's guitar. Just such a really, really good, tight record. And still love it to this day. And I've got the Bandstand album, which looks like an old TV. Absolutely amazing. So, another Bowie album. We're coming up to 1973 now, and Bowie bought out, it was a lull period, and he still had the Spiders with him, amazing band, and he did a covers album called Pinups, and I bought that. It had the amazing Mick Rocks photography again on it, very, very typical Bowie, but had the amazing cover with Bowie and Twiggy on the front, just headshots. And I bought it literally the day it came out, and this single predated it by a month or so, and it's Sorrow on the RCA label. An absolutely amazing track, a great version of a Pretty Things track, and that whole album of covers, pinups by Bowie is a superb album. God knows how many copies I've got of it, but I simply love it. As you can see, I was into that glam rock sort of period. Another great band from that time. My brother had their first couple of albums. Then I bought Stranded by the amazing Roxy Music. Eno had long gone by this time, and was replaced with Eddie Jobson, who played keys, sound effects, and guitar and violins. But this Street Life track is just so different from anything else at the time. The band looked amazing, and simply a great, great single on the amazing Pink Rim Island label, which is just a label of the time and just a fantastic record. Really famous with A Night of the Opera and their classic Bohemian Rhapsody, but I was into Queen a lot earlier. I'd bought Seven Seas of Rye on single, fascinated by the band. It's quite heavy, and I bought their first album, but it wasn't until Killer Queen that I really, really got into Queen, and this is Killer Queen single, 1974. It's got the little Trident logo there from the Trident Recording Studios, where I eventually worked in late 78 through to 81. Another reason besides Bowie and Elton John that I went there, knew what a famous studio it was, and produced by the amazing Roy Thomas Baker. This was so different. I saw Queen live and they did a great version of this. It's just a superb record. And even today when you hear it, it is so different from anything from that period and even today. And it still sounds fresh. If this came out today, you know, people would go out and buy it. It's a great record. She keeps a Moët Chandon in a pretty cabin. She says, just like Marie Antoinette. Bit of a link here to Bowie. He wrote a song called All the Young Dudes, and the story is that he gave it to Mott the Hoople, and it really pushed them up into the fame charts. And there probably wasn't a time in around this period, so I'm talking 73, 74, where Mott the Hoople weren't on Top of the Pops. They had so many singles, Roll Away the Stone and some great records, as well as All the Young Dudes. So I followed them. I bought all the albums as they came out. I went back in their catalogue and bought the early albums, which weren't as good, but still, I still love them. But I really thought that Ian Hunter was probably the coolest frontman of any band I'd seen. He had a real sort of LA draw to his, what was actually a Northern accent. He's written a great book called The Story of a Rock and Roll Band or something, but it's all about touring in the 70s. But this single burst onto Top of the Pops. I rushed out to buy it. It's called Once Bitten, Twice Shy, and it was from an album called just by Ian Hunter, but arranged and produced by Ian Hunter and Mick Ronson. And Mick Ronson played with Mott and with Ian Hunter for many years. Superb guitarist, obviously originated from the Spiders from Mars with Bowie. And this is such a good record. If you want to get any party going, stick this on, and it's just such a big up record.
Hello.
So that was 1975, a great year for singles. I've got many from that period, but we were starting to get a bit more sort of funky and smooth. You could see things were heading towards disco and stuff. But before that really kicked in, there was this great record that came out by a band called Stretch called Why did you do it? And it's it really, really is a superb record. It's so well produced. It's on the Anchor label. Why Did You Do It by Stretch. This single, God, it was on practically every jukebox in Western Supermare, where I was brought up and used to go out to bars. It was on every jukebox, and most of the local cover bands would do this track. It is the most amazing funky track, and just superb. I think One Hit Wonder, this is their one hit. Into the shops, and it had great cover art, and I'm a firm believer that many albums are famous and sell well because of their cover art, and this is no exception. The album was Year of the Cat by Al Stewart, and this is the single that came out to promote that album. Absolutely superb album. I must have about 5 copies of it in various different formats, and vinyl reissues. There isn't a bad track on this album, and this is the finest track. It has an amazing sort of acoustic solo, keyboard solo, saxophone solo partway through it. It builds up. It's just a superb track, and I'm sure many, many people have an affection for this record. I've followed Al Stewart to this day. I have practically every album that he's ever done. From his early acoustic folky stuff all the way through to this period and beyond into the 80s and right up to date. And I've never seen him live. I hope to try and do that next year if he's touring again. He's in his, well into his 70s now, but a great singer-songwriter, great record, and one of my favourites. This was co-written with Peter Wood, and Peter Wood's an amazing guitarist. He has a great YouTube channel. If you watch him, he's always touring and supporting Al Stewart, so try and listen to some of his stuff. A keyboard player, I think, originally, but also a great guitarist, and he tours around doing solo work as well as working with the likes of Al Stewart. Was 76, and obviously many other singles at that time. Still a great time for singles, but that was they're the standouts for me. But God Save the Queen by Sex Pistols came out in Jubilee year. The Sex Pistols, my God, what a difference to everything that was going on. Really scary when you first heard about them and all the stories. A lot of it, obviously, as you get older, you realize it's all hype from Malcolm McLaren, but you know, what a great band. Probably one of the best rock and roll albums ever made, never mind the bollocks. And this single, and at the time that it was the Silver Jubilee, this came out on Virgin, God Save the Queen. An absolutely stunning, stunning record. I was into a lot of, American music, Dylan, everything like that. And then this broke onto the scenes, and I just rushed out and bought this. And it's just superb. Everybody knows about the Pistols. Probably one of the most famous bands in the world after the Beatles and the Stones. And this record produced by Chris Thomas on Virgin is absolutely stunning. Still play it to this day, still love it. Now we're in punk period. I got really into it. My girlfriend at the time, her younger brother was massively into punk rock. We used to go to this cafe in Weston-super-Mare called John's Eating Palace, and we used to buy all the latest singles that had come out, and like the Adverts and Gary Gilmore's Eyes and various other records like that. And you know, that's where I got massively into punk. Mainly singles. I did buy a few punk albums, but they weren't really album bands. They were really singles bands. Except for this band called The Stranglers and Something Better Change. This single was the one that really got me into The Stranglers. It's, you know, you buy the album, which at the time was Ratus Navegicus, and it's almost getting towards post-punk. You know, it's very much prog punk, if you like. You know, long songs, great tunes, great lyrics, and just a superb record, this one. This is the original I had at the time. It's got this red and white United Artists label, and it's got Straighten Out on the flip side, and that was produced by Martin Rushent. He's quite a famous producer of that period. But love The Stranglers, still love them today. But really, you need Hugh Cornwell on guitar and vocals for that band to really, really shine. And the first two albums, this one and No More Heroes, and the single No More Heroes, absolute favourites of mine. One thing that came along with punk was a love of reggae, and I got massively into reggae, especially during the 80s, and practically everything I bought was a reggae album, usually an import, and a lot of them came on the Green Sleeves label. But I only got into punk, probably obviously Bob Marley. I'd heard Bob Marley live when I was a kid. My brother had that, 1975 I think. And love that album, No Woman, No Cry. I think he bought that because, you know, Clapton had done that, or the other way around, and he got into that. But this single, out of the many, many reggae singles, this is probably the first single I got which I would call, you know, real reggae. It's on the Greensleeves record label, 1977. And it was made, it was made sort of cult favourite by Johnny Rotten, John Lydon, at the time. He used to say that when he was down, you know, just during the Pistols time, he would go and play this on his deck, and it's called Reason for Living. It's the B-side of a track called Born for a Purpose, on the Amazing Greensleeves record label. Many famous reggae bands, you know, recorded on here, produced by Winston Thompson. Just a superb track, but Reason for Living, it's just a record I've played over and over again, and this still sounds great today, and that really got me into reggae, real reggae as I call it, as opposed, you know, Jamaican reggae, rootsy reggae, as opposed to the sort of pop reggae, which was more probably Bob Marley. Thank you. So, during the very hot summer, 76 going into 77, I used to go around to my friend Steve's house, and we just used to play Dylan records and Hotel California and all the rest of it. And our favourite Marley album was Exodus, and this is the original single from that album, on the wonderful Island Sunset label. And it's got Exodus on one side with vocal and without vocal on the other side. Fantastic record, on a great label, from a great artist who I followed. The big single after this was Is This Love, which I also have on picture disc as well. Picture sleeve, but a really good track as well. But this one, I only wanted to choose one from each artist, and this one, apart from Bowie, and this one is probably my favourite Marley track. As we start to come out of the punk period, a lot of American sort of post-punk kicked off. Great album by Television, their first album, Marquee Moon. I've got lots of singles from that period. But this single in particular, you can see I've written on the sleeve, which is Roadrunner by Jonathan Richmond, on the Berserkly label. Something about this, it was so simple and so different. They also did a track called Egyptian Reggae, which I've also got the single of, the original one. And I've had this since 1977, and I only realised, having watched Dave Hepworth on his YouTube channel today, talking about it at someone else. And he was a promoter for Berserkly Records. And they had to promote this, and they had these two tracks, or they had to find something to put on side two. And if you read the label, it says Roadrunner once and Roadrunner twice on the flip side. And the difference is, I didn't really know what the difference was. I mean, they obviously sound different. But the A side is Jonathan Richmond, Roadrunner, Jonathan Richmond. And on the B side is his band, The Modern Lovers, doing a version of Roadrunner. So, and that was Dave Hepworth's idea, apparently. He claims that, and that's why we've got that on two sides. So, a really great single. Pity I scribbled on the cover, trying to be creative. Not too bad, I suppose. But still the original sleeve, the original track. I had the album of this as well, but this single is just fantastic.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Roadrunner, roadrunner.
So, as I said at the beginning, this whole show and tell of these 20 favourite records of mine, these stop at 1978. So we're coming towards the end of the punk period. We're getting into 1978, and the Clash are on their second album, which is called Give 'Em Enough Rope. And weirdly, the record label CBS, quite a weird label to be on as a punk band, I think, you know, big corporation like that. But anyway, their second album, the record label decided to get in producer Sandy Pearlman, who'd produced Blue Oyster Cult records. And some of those are pretty thin sounding. And they're great albums, but they're not, you know, they're a bit sort of smooth, really, if you like, and a weird choice for The Clash. And of course, I bought Give Them Enough Rope, the album, love it still, but it's got some poppy tunes on it. And I think there isn't one Clash album that actually sounds the same as another Clash album. But this track on this single was an absolute stunner. And if you ever went to see The Clash at the time, and I did many, many times, they used to come to Bristol. I saw them in London as well. They often used to start with Tommy Gunn, with an amazing Topperheaden drum roll at the beginning, and just really crashing into what is a really, really good, solid track, and much more in the vein of classic Clash compared to the rest of the album. But this, it's a great, great single. It's got a pretty lame track on side two called 1-2 Crush on You, but the actual single itself is superb. This is my original copy. It's Strummer Jones compilation, of course, and it really is such a great single, and one of my favourites. Every time I hear it, still love it. I mean, London Calling's another one as well, but this one is just superb. Finally, on to the 20th single of this this selection. I guess the Pistols were never going to last long. They burst onto the scene. I was going to see them in Bristol's Bamboo Club. It got burnt down the night before they played. There was a lot of people didn't want them to play, mainly because of they associated them with violence for some reason. And I never got to see them, but I did get to see Johnny Rotten's next band called Public Image Limited, or PIL. I've seen them a few times, and the first single that came out was just so solid. It originally came out in a newspaper cover, so it was like a fold-out newspaper. And it was quite different. It was definitely post-punk, still quite intimidating vocals from John Lydon, as he was called then, John Lydon. The most amazing guitar riff on this from Keith Levine, who sadly, you know, got heavily into drugs, and he's no longer with the band. But this is probably one of the finest singles ever made, and it's Public Image, self-titled Public Image. And the other side is the Cowboy Song, not so great. But this one single was just simply amazing. And it's got Jar Wobble on bass, of course. So and very very intimidating vocals, really attacking about the record industry. Superb return to form after the Pistols, and then Lydon leaving the Pistols. And we thought, well, you know, what next? Is there going to be anything? And then this came out. And they've had a solid career ever since, still a great band, still bringing out great music. And John Lydon's hilarious. He's such an intelligent guy. And yeah, this is just a superb single. So I'm going to leave it there in 1978. Started in 70, which was When I'm Dead and Gone. We've gone from, you know, those early sort of rock tracks through glam, and then into punk, and then out the other side of punk into reggae and post-punk, and ended up with Public Image. So some great singles, I hope you enjoyed this, and I might come back and do something else soon. See you later.